All right, welcome once again to Christ Clarity Satsang, where we dare to clarify what the remedy is and what our problem is. I just finished an hour of by far and away the best satsang I've ever done. I felt it was perfect, but there was one flaw, one little flaw in it. And that little flaw was that YouTube failed to record it. So it's not available. How about that? That's actually a big flaw, isn't it? Which leads us to the essential message of that satsang. And let's see if I can recapture it. I should be able to. What I spoke about in that near-perfect satsang, or actually deeply flawed because it wasn't recorded, is that the ego plays a game with us, a very tricky game, and let's explore what that is. The ego claims that it's making a super great deal with us, and that it is making a bargain in agreeing to have only one exception to truth. The ego starts out with infinite exceptions to truth. And then it bargains with you, and finally it throws up its hands and says, okay, you win. I'll just agree to one exception to truth, and I'll get rid of all the others. And that's like the last, greatest, unbelievable deal for you. And the ego fully expects you to accept this deal with great gratitude and to believe that this deal is the perfect deal. You've made the perfect deal. Now, the ego will try to sanctify this one exception to truth, and will dress it up in the robes of sanctity, and will tell you to worship this one exception to truth, and that this is the ultimate for you. Okay, now, we know the voice of reason, which we all have within us, which is put there by God, the prime creator. We are spirit, and that voice of truth reminds us of what we are and tells us, there's no such thing as exception to truth. This is the key teaching of all satsang, that the key that will free you literally from unbelievable misery. There's no such thing as exception to truth. Even the tiniest belief in exception to truth means you don't know truth at all. You're rejecting it entirely. But the ego continuously tricks us into believing that somehow one exception to truth is a much better deal than two exceptions to truth. The ego tells you that it's giving you 99% truth and only 1% lies. Okay, and that in doing so, it is bending over backwards and doing you an incredible favor. All of this is total nonsense. But this is the trap the ego lays for us. It says, there has to be at least one exception to truth. It's only fair, you know, that there's one. It doesn't even go that far. It just gets dualistic or relative with you, saying, look, I gave up all these other exceptions, and now you can at least leave me with one. I mean, if you don't, you're incredibly unfair and ungracious. If you don't leave me with at least one exception, I mean, if you don't leave me with one, what can I give you? See, the ego wants to give us something, but all the ego can give us is a lie. That's all they can give us. You see, the ego is just a sum total, it's a term meaning the sum total of marketing devices that mind is using to present spirit, the idea of spirit being prime creator. And to do this, spirit has to be in a deep state of forgetfulness of what it is. Because if it knows what it is, it knows that it's an extension of the mind of God, and that God is the prime creator and spirit is the prime created, the prime extension of the mind of God. And therefore, spirit is not prime creator. So spirit has to forget this. Has to be in a deep state of forgetfulness. And to do this, it employs all these very, very tricky tactics. But the most tricky of all is for the ego to claim that it's made the ultimate sacrifice for you, and that it's agreed to only have one exception to truth instead of the many that it claims are justifiable and plausible. The ego thinks it's given up almost everything for you, that you've taken it to the cleaners. You know, you've made this incredibly shrewd deal, and now you've accepted one exception to truth instead of many, and that's the best deal you can possibly make. And so you should be overjoyed by this, and you should celebrate this, and you should worship this, and you should tell yourself how great you are for having chosen just one exception to truth, and that you think this one exception to truth is your salvation, and that you've managed to avoid the other exceptions to truth. That's called dualism. Non-dualism sees through this sham of the ego. Dualism says that one exception to truth is less than two exceptions to truth. That's what dualism really is. And it's a total lie. The lie is that there's any such thing as any exception to truth, even the tiniest exception. The tiniest exception to truth entertained isn't actually a 100% rejection of truth. Doesn't matter if you're making a billion exceptions to truth or one, all exactly the same. They're all 100% rejections of truth, because the very nature of truth is that there's no way to modify truth. There's no way to change it. There's no way to make an exception to it. It's impossible. So to say that you have one exception to truth is exactly the same as to say you're making a billion exceptions to truth. Exactly the same. No difference. This is the essence of non-dual teaching. This is the essence of Christ Clarity Satsang. Christ Clarity meaning clarity about Christ. Clarity about your spirit, about what you are, and clarity about the overlay, which is what occurs when you choose the idea of not being prime creator, then everything that arises in your dream of forgetfulness is overlaid by an effect that doesn't change at all, that is unmodifiable, cannot be modified, is not being modified by anything. The dance of existence continues, but the effect, the overlay of all that, is not being modified by it one bit. One, not at all. No exception to that. And it's the no exception quality of the overlay. It's the seamless quality. It's the peace beyond understanding, the seamlessness of the garment. That's what reminds us of what we are, because there is no exception to what we are. What we are cannot be modified. And so the only way to remember this, what we are, is to experience a fact that is not modifiable. That's why there's only one way. There are many who have chosen this way, the one way. And each one of those who have chosen this are what I call touchstones. They remind us that it is possible for us to do this. They remind us that the remedy is there for us. It's right at hand. And all we have to do is exercise a simple choice. Now, the ego distracts us from this. We have the power and the authority at all, every moment, to choose a new idea, to choose the idea of not being prime creator, not trying to be prime creator. Every moment, we have the simple power and authority and capability to do this. So the ego knows this, and the ego feels very, very threatened by this. So what the ego does is it tries to distract us from exercising this authority and power and capability by telling us we need to develop all sorts of other powers and trying to show us the way to do this. You know, if we do all these mantras and asanas and meditations and prayers and this and this and that, we can develop all these powers, these cities, these psychic powers, mental powers, all these different powers that the ego tells us, you know, this will make us really great, it'll make us really in control, it'll make us be able to do so many things. And so the ego sprinkles this fairy dust in our eyes and deceives us this way, because as we're pursuing the development of all these other so-called powers, we're neglecting to exercise the power that we already have right now, which is the power to choose a new idea. And that choosing a new idea is the remedy. It's a complete sovereign remedy. It leaves no trouble untouched. All troubles are overlaid by the overlay. The overlay is not modifiable. And so there's no trouble at all in the overlay. It's a perfect reminder of what we are. And we have the power and capacity and authority within us as what we are to choose this idea. We were created by the prime creator to choose ideas, that with the power and the authority and the capability and the willingness to choose ideas and experience them. And we had freedom to choose any and all ideas we wanted to choose. And the prime creator told us, don't choose the idea of trying to be prime creator, because that's going to cause you to fall into a deep sleep of forgetfulness. And what do? we said, hey, I want to try that one. I want to see what happens. And, you know, now we know what happens. So the ego, to keep us in this deep state of forgetfulness, the ego has to distract us away from exercising the power we feel within us by telling us we can develop all these other powers and glamorizing these other powers as if they were somehow important. The fact is, they're a complete waste of time. Because we already have the power that we need. There's no need to seek any other power at all. It's useless, totally useless. And so, Christ Clarity Satsang is reminding us of this fact. Fact that all we need to do is choose a new idea. And automatically from that, choosing that new idea, the effect, the overlay effect arises. The effect which cannot be modified by any other effect. Automatically. We don't need to do anything. Automatically arises. Peace beyond understanding. Automatically arises. Overlays everything equally. All spatial relationships, events in time and space, both in this life and in all the afterlives, all dimensions, all places, all imaginings, all dreams, all speculation, all concepts, all actions, everything is equally overlaid with no distinction whatsoever, because the whole point of the overlay is to give us an effect that is not modifiable, because only that will remind us of what we really are. Any other effect that is modifiable, even the slightest bit, will not remind us of what we are. It will only remind us of a lie about what we are. That lie being that what we are can be modified at least a little bit, which is the ego's whole song and dance. You see, the ego is like this super salesperson. And it knows how to trick you, manipulate you, and make you think that it's doing you a great, great, great favor. And that to turn your back on this favor is the most ungracious thing imaginable. And when we say no deal, ego, we say, you know what, one lie is about the self, about truth. One exception is the same as a billion exceptions. It's a complete rejection of truth. The ego gets furious when we see through this ploy, because that's all it has. That's all that the ego has is lies. That's all it has to peddle. And when you reject its ultimate lie, which is to say one exception to truth is somehow different than two exceptions, the ego has nothing left. Has nothing left to trick you with. Again, the ego is trying to convince you that one exception to truth is different than two exceptions. And Christ Clarity Satsang assures you that there's absolutely no difference between one exception to truth and two exceptions and a billion exceptions. It's all exactly the same, which is a complete rejection of truth, a complete denial of truth, and a failure to see truth whatsoever. It's a total rejection, 100% rejection, because there is no exception to truth. Truth cannot be modified, plain and simple. Hearing this is true empowerment. Empowerment means to remind you that you have the power right now to choose a new idea. And of course the ego gets furious when you see this, because it's put all its marbles into getting you to try and worship its notion of one exception. The ego will say this one exception is the perfect remedy for you, because it's either that or many, many multiple exceptions, and the multiple exceptions will cause you great misery, but the one exception won't. If you just accept this one exception to truth, if you just accept it and believe in it, that somehow this is the cure for you. Total lie, right? The ultimate lie of the ego that keeps you in a state of forgetfulness of what you are, which keeps you in a state of fear and misery, keeps you from experiencing peace, from experiencing love, from experiencing the rich tapestry of reality, keeps you from experiencing stability, perfect poise, and the absolutely splendid bliss of spirit. Keeps you from experiencing all of that. How fair is that? What kind of deal is that? That's the worst deal possible, isn't it? So really, by the ego claiming there's one exception to truth, that's the worst deal possible. Because that's the only way that it can really present it. You know, for the very foolish, the ego might claim that many exceptions are better than one, but after a while, the ego, as you put the pressure on the ego and your misery, the ego finally will go down to this gambit of, well, one exception is really the ultimate. That's the ego's ace up its sleeve. You know, the ace up the ego's sleeve is to say, yeah, one exception. The ego says, well, I didn't really want to give you that, but you forced me. You forced my hand through your incredible desire for truth, etc. So I'll admit that actually the one exception is the real remedy, and that the others were not really the best deal for you. But now I'm being completely open and honest with you and saying that the one exception is really the way. And you'll say, oh, at last I've finally seen through the ego's tricks. When in fact you haven't seen through at all. The ego has completely fooled us when it pulls the wool over our eyes that way. But here, we're taking the wool off of our eyes, and the ego doesn't like that one bit, because it doesn't have anything else. There's no fallback on that one. And we rejoice because the bullying days of the ego are over. And this is what satsang is all about. Turning the tables on the ego and saying, no more ego, you won't fool me any longer, you won't bully or intimidate me any longer, ego. Your days of doing that, of fooling me, are over. Doesn't matter what kind of robes of sanctity you wrap up the notion of one exception to truth in, doesn't matter at all. Doesn't matter how many temples or churches or buildings or places of worship you build, none of that matters. Doesn't matter what kind of idols you place in those places. Doesn't matter the prayers and rituals you make. Doesn't matter the dogma you give rise to. None of that matters at all, because we've seen the essential principle is that making an exception to truth, however small, is a total rejection of truth. And what has told us this? The voice of reason. Where does the voice of reason come from? Came from God, the Prime Creator. Soon as Spirit chose the idea of trying to be Prime Creator, God put the voice of reason within Spirit, gave a blessing to Spirit, like a gift, saying, here's the voice of reason. This voice of reason will be able to see through the ego's gambits, the tricks, the marketing devices of the ego. And will be able to help you see this very, very clearly, what's really going on. And then you'll be able to choose a new idea and exercise the power that you have right now, instead of seeking some other types of power, trying to develop all other types of powers, psychic powers, etc. Waste of time. The voice of reason will tell you this. Spend your time in satsang. Spend your time listening to the highest clarifications. And that will tell you, you already have the power. That's why some teachers say, give up the seeking. You don't need to seek anything. You already have the power within you. Always have had it. The remedy is always right at hand. The kingdom of heaven is at hand. Right now, you can choose to not try and be Prime Creator. You can choose to, that automatically gives rise to the effect of the perfect overlay, the vision of oneness, the vision of Christ, nirvana. That which doesn't change, that's which is not moving, that which cannot be modified. There's no modification taking place. Some will call it perfect emptiness. That's another term that has been used. Perfect emptiness. Perfect emptiness, that reminds us of what we are, because in perfect emptiness, nothing is being modified, right? So there have been different ways to refer to this overlay. I'm using the term the overlay. The term Christ actually means overlay. It refers to an oil. Things were anointed with oil or overlaid with oil, and the oil gives an equal spread over everything. When you rub something with oil, rub it down, the oil seems to be equally distributed perfectly, and it covers everything like a thin overlay. That's just a symbolic way of referring to the overlay. This effect that overlays all other effects and is untouched by them, unmodified by them. That is the goal. And it comes about. This is an effect that automatically arises from choosing to not try and be Prime Creator, which is called repentance. In classical terms, it's called repentance. To repent means to change one's idea. Repent means to choose a new idea. That's what it actually means. To choose once again. Repensar. To think once again. Rethink the situation. To choose a new idea. To make a new choice. Choose once again. Course in Miracles says, choose once again. must choose once again. That's it. And you have that power already. It's not a power you need to develop. It's inherent within what you are. But as long as you believe that there's an exception to what you are, you will then think you have to develop some kind of new power, because the power of choosing a new idea has been modified. And so you're trying to figure out, how has it been modified, and how can you then develop a modified power? And that then causes you all this entrapment in the existence, in all existence, in all its subtleties and ways, highways and byways. Whether in this life or some other life, this life, the afterlife, this dimension, other dimensions, it's all the same. It's all an imagined scenario based on lies. An attempt to accomplish the impossible. It's completely futile. Truth cannot be modified in any way. What can modify truth? A lie is just a denial of truth. It's not a modification. And we go back to the ego and its game of insisting that it's given us a fantastic deal, the ultimate deal, but in fact it's given us nothing. And again, it's important to point out, the ego will wrap its deal in sanctity, in symbols of sanctity. And so I have to point this out, because the ego will use any and all terminology, sanctimonious terminology, to wrap its treacherous gift in. And it can be any term, any sacred term referring to sacred beings, divinity, whatever. Absolutely wraps it up in the sanctimonious cloak to sell to you and claim to tell you, look how divine this is. Look how wonderful it is. This is certainly your salvation. And actually, it's your damnation. Because by accepting, believing that exception to truth is possible, you lose sight of all truth. Can't see it. It's as if it doesn't exist for you, and you fall into this deep sleep of forgetfulness. Or, in our case, we maintain it, which we don't want to do. We're coming out of that. We don't want to keep buying into this treacherous deal the ego keeps offering us, wrapped up in the robes of sanctity. And the ego claims that we're attacking sanctity, you know, by rejecting this treacherous deal somehow, we're attacking sanctity. We're attacking the robes, you know, that it's wrapped up, attacking the names that it's used to refer to this one exception to truth. When in fact, we're rejecting the ego's treacherous, lying deal to us, rejecting it all. And simply affirming truth, which is that there is no exception to truth. There's no modification of truth at all. None. And affirming truth is absolutely the will of God. So we're doing the will of God by affirming truth and saying there is no exception to truth. And it doesn't matter how sanctimonious that exception to truth is made. It makes no difference. It's all still zero. And the ego fumes at this and says, the ego thinks it's done such a great job in making this one exception to truth sanctimonious, that how dare we, you know, reject it. That the ego says that rejecting this is rejecting God, you know, because surely God is very pleased by how sanctimonious the ego has made this exception to truth. No, God is not pleased in the slightest bit. God sees right through the ego's gambit. It's easy. We can see right through it. Surely God, the Prime Creator, can see through it perfectly. From the very beginning, God, the Prime Creator, knew that we would attempt to claim that one exception to truth is somehow the ultimate deal, and that is our salvation, and we tried to wrap it up in sanctity. The Prime Creator saw all of that and gave us the voice of reason, which tells us what a treacherous deal this is. It's no deal at all. It's zero. Gives us zero. Gives us nothing. And if it gives us nothing, how can that be a deal? It's not a deal at all. It's deception. The ego doesn't offer deals, it offers deception. Everybody can follow this. And some are afraid that the ego will remove even this deal from the table. And says the ego say, okay, well, I'm going to give you nothing. It's already giving us nothing. So nothing changes. Nothing changes. The ego claims that it's going to give us nothing at all. It's going to remove the deal. Or it's going to say, okay, you don't want one exception of truth. You've got to accept multiple exceptions then, and you're going to be very miserable. Not true. Because again, the ego's deal is always nothing. It's giving us nothing. Whether one exception to truth or infinite exceptions to truth, it's all the same, zero, nothing. It's all just a total lie from the very beginning. The ego is a liar and deceiver from the very beginning. One tiny exception to truth believed is exactly the same as infinite exceptions. It's all zero. It's all not true. It's all equally not true. There's no reason to make any distinctions at all between them, which is why the overlay doesn't need to make any distinctions whatsoever. The overlay doesn't need to modify itself in order to remind us what we are. The overlay doesn't need to have at least one exception to what it is, at least one modification. It's not like we experience the overlay and then we have to search and seek out where the modification is so that we're reminded of what we are. That's not the case, and here come some people up the driveway. Just a minute. I don't know why they're coming up here. Hold on just a second. Yeah, I'm busy right now. You have to come back. Okay, thank you. Okay, so some people pedaling something just came up the driveway and where I was recording. And then they saw I was recording. I just told them, hey, I'm busy. And they were trying to sell me something, sign some petition. And I just said, hey, I'm busy. And they saw that. And they said, okay, have a nice day. And they left. You have to do that with the ego. You know, the ego will come up and it wants to sell you its great deal. You know, sign up. It's signing you up. It tells you it's signing you up for the greatest deal there is. Just sign up. Sign here. You have to say, no, I'm sorry. I'm busy. I'm busy remembering truth. I'm busy with satsang. Satsang is really your salvation in that it brings you into very close clarity, very great clarity of what your salvation really is. So it's a means to an end. It's not an end in itself, but it's a vital means to an end. So it's part of, you can say it is part of the entirety, the totality of your salvation. It's part of it. It's not the essential part of it. But it's very, very important part of it, because only by this means does one develop the clarity and importance and see through the ego, see through its gambits. I tell you, those who have not put the time and effort into satsang, into clarification, remain deluded. They remain convinced that somehow they've accepted the ultimate deal from the ego, and that their embracing of one exception to truth is somehow the ultimate deal, and they just need to embrace it a little more, and they need everybody else to embrace it too. You see, that's the problem. They say, you know, if just to get everybody to embrace it, then somehow that deal will work, because it doesn't really work for them. But the ego tells them, well, the problem is not with the deal that you've embraced. The problem is that others are not embracing it. So you need to get them to embrace it. And if they resist, you've got to, you know, force them into it if necessary. That's what the ego tells them. So you have then those people who have bought into this notion that one exception to truth is the ultimate deal on the way to salvation. They want you to, they insist that you share, that you embrace it also. And if you don't, they get frightened because they say, oh, it's not going to work for me unless everybody embraces it. The ego tells them that. But I tell you this for certain, that by choosing a new idea, the effect, the idea of not trying to be prime creator, the effect of that, the overlay effect will arise, and it will give you perfect remembrance of what you are, and this is not independent at all on anybody else choosing it. Totally independent of anyone else's choice. In other words, even if everyone else in the cosmos did not choose this, it would still be perfectly effective for you. And so you have absolutely no reason to try to force it on anybody. None. But out of compassion, you share. That is all. But there is no threat to you that if you don't get others to choose it, that somehow it's not going to be effective for you. Not at all. It will be 100% effective for you. That is why those who have chosen it in the past, it's been perfectly effective for them, even though we here have not chosen it yet. Didn't diminish the effectiveness for them one bit. So you can see the vast difference between God's plan of salvation and the ego's plan of salvation. The ego's plan of salvation doesn't work. The ego hides this by claiming it's not working because you haven't got others to accept it, and somehow there's some guilt in you for not doing this, and that this is somehow hindering its effectiveness for you. Absolute nonsense. God's plan of salvation is effective for you from the very get-go, and will always be effective for you. Whether or not anybody else chooses it or not makes no difference. That's why those who choose it are very, very peaceful. They attract through their presence. They're not peddling, marketing anything. They're sharing the truth with those that are attracted to it. There's no hard sell. The hard sell is, of course, that everyone must eventually choose remembrance of what they are. It's the will of God that spirit is what it is. It cannot change or modify what it is. So everyone must eventually, every aspect of spirit must eventually choose remembrance of what it is. No choice in that whatsoever. So that's beyond a hard sell. That is absolute necessity. So seeing this absolute necessity, those touchstones who have chosen the overlay, out of compassion, they do present this truth and do so in an urgent manner and inform everyone of the importance of it, because it's a necessity. It's unavoidable necessity. So they're coming from that perspective. Not that anybody needs to choose it anyone else needs to choose it in order for it to be effective. Not at all. Not at all. And you can tell that these touchstones, by others rejecting it and saying, no, I'm not going to do it, it doesn't affect the quality of their peace at all. You can tell that. That's why they're touchstones. That's why you know it's different than the ego's plan. Whereas the ego's plan, if someone markets the ego's plan to you of choosing one exception to truth and trying to wrap that in sanctimonious robes, and you reject that and say, no, I don't want to do that, it causes them great disturbance. They're very disturbed by that, because they feel the effectiveness for them is somehow affected by this. And so therefore, that's how you know. The touchstones, you see no change at all in their peace if you reject choosing choosing a new idea. No change in their peace whatsoever. No anger whatsoever. No disturbance whatsoever. Their blessing, the radiance of peace shines out to you exactly the same as before. Whereas in the egos, those who choose the egos, false way of salvation, the fake way, the way it doesn't work, they get very frightened and agitated if you reject that way. Because the ego has to hide the ineffectiveness by claiming it will become effective if you get someone else to agree to it. Kind of like a pyramid scheme, a Ponzi scheme, isn't it? It's a scheme. It doesn't work. The ego is always scheming, telling you doesn't work because you need to do something more. Of course, the only thing you need to do is choose a new idea. But the ego insists you not do this and try to compensate for not doing this. Try to find some other way that works. And of course, no other way works. Because all other ways are based on the belief that at least some modification is true. Some modification of truth is true. That it's actually happened. It's a fact. And I can tell you from having glimpsed truth that it's not a fact. Truth has not been modified. It's not modifiable. That's a certainty. I'm not just speculating on that. It's an absolute certainty because I've experienced it. Now, like many having experienced it, we get pulled back into the ego's demands, because the ego is very shrill in its demands and saying, you know, you must get others to, you know, agree to it before you can experience it. You know, it's unfair for you to experience it without getting others. You must forego your experiencing of it and work to get others to experiencing it. Based, again, that's reinforcing the ego's belief in its plan that doesn't work. That the reason why it doesn't work is you haven't gotten others to do it. So the ego plays this game of fairness and guilt and all of that, trying to convince you that before you experience it, that it can't possibly remain, you can't continue to experience it without first getting others to experience it. So we get caught up in that guilt game. We get caught up in it. And that's what prevents us. That's what holds us back. So what I'm speaking to you here and sharing with you is, what is holding us back from actually experiencing the peace that we deserve? And it's this guilt game by the ego. The ego projects its plan onto God's plan and says that you have to, you have to immediately, once you experience it, you must immediately then account for the modifications that must take place in it and modify your approach to it, and get caught up in that. And then you must also find a way to ensure that others accept this before you can actually experience the benefits of it. All these deals that the ego claims you must do takes you away from it. But it's really that simple. I mean, you can disagree with the ego. Now, of course, when you disagree with the ego gets furious. No question about it. When you don't submit to the ego's demands, ego becomes furious because it doesn't have anything else. If you don't go along with its guilt trip, it doesn't have anything else for you. You know, nothing else to offer you. Only guilt, only fear, only failure. And telling you the failure is because you're failing to do something that needs to be done, failing to develop the powers that need to be developed, failing to force others into embracing the same false plan. And it will never admit that its plan simply doesn't work. It's a zero. It's nothing. It will never tell you that. The purpose of satsang is to tell you that. The purpose of someone like myself is to tell you that. To pass on what has been clarified for me, what I've been shown to be true. To share that. Simply share it. Share the clarity. That's what happens in a wisdom culture. Sharing of clarity. And we're very fortunate that this clarity has been shared with the world in various formats. And I credit them all. Again, every touchstone, everyone that chooses a new idea deserves credit for doing this, for helping us out. Give credit where credit is due. There have been many in the past. They're not asking for credit, but it helps us to at least remember some of these touchstones. We can either remember one, or we can remember several, or we can remember many. Whatever helps us, whatever works for us. The whole point is to remind us that our power of choice is with us right now, always will be with us, always has been with us. And the ego is just distracting us from exercising this power that we have. The ego will tell you, you have so many spiritual powers, so many spiritual experiences. You need to experience all of these. That'll somehow add to the richness of you, what you are able to cause spirit to grow and expand in consciousness, and all of this song and dance you've heard. I'm sure you've heard it all, or most of it, as I certainly have too. This is the ego song and dance to distract you from exercising the power, the one power you need, the one power you have, the power to choose a new idea. You don't need any spiritual experiences to exercise this power. You don't need any spirituality. You don't need any psychic abilities. You don't need any subtle powers. You don't need to know how to levitate or bilocate or telepathy or precognition. You don't need to do miracles. You don't need to do anything. You simply need to exercise the power that is within you to choose a new idea. That's it. That's all that's necessary. That's the only power that actually works. That's the only power that saves us. The only one. The God-given power, the prime creator-given power to choose another idea. Choose a new idea. That's how we as spirit function. If we want to experience rich tapestry of effects, we choose an idea. And the automatically mind presents this unbelievably beautiful and wonderful spontaneous expansion and experiencing of that idea. That's how reality functions. And we, spirit, are the chooser of ideas. So it's completely natural and native to us, an unmodified power that we have. Remember, what we are has not been modified at all. So our power to choose a new idea has not been modified. And the availability of ideas has not been modified. And the capability of mind to present those ideas to us has not been modified at all. It's all still there in pristine condition. Flawless, perfect functionality. Doesn't wear down. It's not like an engine that wears down over time. You see, in time, everything wears down. And that seems to give us plausible evidence that our functionality also is wearing down. Not true. That's a lie. All this existence bears false witness to what we really are. False witnessing. Designed by mind to induce this deep forgetfulness of what we are, because that's what's necessary to at least entertain plausibly the notion that we can be prime creator, is simply self-deception, self-forgetfulness. That's all we have, is a plausible feeling that maybe we can be prime creators. Because we don't see any evidence to the contrary. Because we're focused on all this false evidence. Of course, if we take a glimpse at reality, we'll see perfect evidence to the contrary. That evidence cannot be that reality cannot be modified. We will see that absolutely clearly. And we'll know for sure. And then we take that and we look at what the ego's offering us. And we say, whoa, wait a minute, ego. You're just a slick salesperson. Very slick. And you've been deceiving us for a long, long time. But now we're seeing through it. Now we're realizing it is deception. It's not a deal, it's deception. But the ego is offering us not a deal, it's deception. It's the false claim that one exception to truth is different than many exceptions to truth. And of course, you can feel right now how it's plausible that you could be tricked that way. We could all, and I assure you, we've all been tricked that way. There's no shame in that, because we wanted to be deceived. We've all been tricked by this, thinking that somehow one exception to truth is a better deal than many. This is core. This is core. This is key. You have the key in your hands right now. You have the key in your clarity right now. You can feel that. You probably can feel it. Like, wow, I've got it. It's clear. And there's no doubt about it. And of course, the guilt will come in again and say, gee, I need to go write a book about it or something, because it won't be valid for me unless I bring everybody else into it or something like that. Not true. What's important is the touchstones show us that it's valid no matter what. No matter what. The overlay is not modifiable. And it's already there for us. It's automatically the effect of not trying to be prime creator of that idea. It's not dependent on anything. It's not dependent on us agreeing with it, or how many people agree with it. If 10 agree with it, it's valid. And if 2 agree with it, it's not valid. It's valid, period. It's already present for everyone. Already present. It's already perfectly available for every aspect of spirit. From the very beginning, it was perfectly present and valid for every aspect of spirit, and will always remain so. So there's zero guilt. That option is eternally available. And the capability to choose that is eternally available. It's already perfectly, flawlessly present in us. It'll always be so. So the ego has no role whatsoever to play in any of this. No role at all. There's no need for any deals. There's no need for any deception. Deception is only necessary when we don't really have a true option. Then the ego presents us with a fake option and dresses it up to make it seem like it's better than any alternative. And that's the game that we have been tricked by for so long, and we don't need to be tricked by it anymore. That's the great, great fact of freedom. That you can see right now and you can realize right now. And it's a great thing that we have the capability to present this satsang worldwide and make it available for everyone that chooses to have to access it at any time, to hear this, to recognize it internally, and realize it's not dependent on anything but truth. Truth is one. There's no exceptions to it. And this, your freedom comes from this fact that freedom is within you. Freedom to choose a new idea. Be reminded of what you are by the old perfect overlay, which is not modifiable by anything. There's no exceptions or modifications to it whatsoever. That is always with us. Always be with us. It's with us right now. It'll be with us every moment, exactly the same way as it's with us right now. Closer we get to seeing that, the closer we get to choosing it, realizing we're not going to be missing anything by choosing it right now. Of course, the ego tells us somehow that if we wait, we'll get more. That's a lie, right? The overlay already overlays everything perfectly. It never increases or decreases in that fact. The fact that it is non-modifiable never changes. How can that change? Ask yourself that. If something, an effect, is perfectly non-modifiable, what change can possibly take place in this effect? The fact that it's non-modifiable is the all-important fact, and that fact doesn't change in any way. Even if you say, well, it expands and becomes more, how can you become more non-modifiable than 100% non-modifiable from the very beginning? It can't be 110% non-modifiable, not even 101%. So here's another trick of the ego that keeps us going in time. The ego might agree with us, yeah, that's the way, the choosing the overlay is the way, but if you just wait a little longer, it'll be even a greater non-modifiableness for you. It'll be greater, and you'll be greater somehow. That's a lie. The first one that chose it will have exactly the same non-modifiable experience as the last one that chooses it. Zero difference. So our waiting doesn't give us more at all. The quality is exactly the same. And it's only the quality that's important. It's only the fact of the non-modifiableness of the overlay. Only that reminds us of what we are. And that has to be exactly the same from the very beginning. Endlessly. It's endlessly exactly the same. It's non-modifiable. It's not 110%, it doesn't become 120% non-modifiable. That's meaningless. It's 100%, meaning no exception. Zero modification taking place. There's zero modification taking place right now. Zero modification taking place forever. So if you wait forever, it'll be exactly the same as if you choose it right now. So what do we gain by waiting? Nothing. And we need to see through this, because this is another of the ego's very clever techniques, tactics of deception, self-deception. Telling you that it's giving you wise advice that if you just wait, you're going to get a little more. And we do fall for that. Once we see through the ego's deal of one exception to truth is greater than a better deal than two, then the ego will shift tactics and say, yeah, okay, but if you just wait a little longer, you're going to get more of the non-modifiableness than if you do it right now. That again is another complete lie. And then the ego pretends to be this wise sage counselor to you that is giving you a better, giving you this great advice of waiting, 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 it'll be better. Not true. quality will be exactly the same now as it was from the very beginning, as it will be endlessly. No change. Zero change. So of course, waiting is folly. We know that. And yet we continue to wait, thinking, you know, maybe it's a better deal. Maybe I'll get a little better deal. So, Satsang points out, no. No better deal. And of course, there again, the ego is furious with that. The ego says, how dare you, you know, cheat yourself out of something better. The ego claims that it's standing up for your greatness, that it's that you're crazy and that you're foolish and that you don't realize that if you just wait, you're going to get something better. And therefore, it's the wise counselor and the wise master that tells you, wait, and you'll get something better. And somehow you're naive and foolish and not realizing this. And that it just waves aside your foolishness. Like, you don't know what you're talking about, the ego says. You just don't realize that by waiting, you get more. And when you stand up to this ego, the bully, and say, no, I won't get any more at all by waiting. Be zero change in what I get. I'll get exactly the same quality now as any other moment. Then again, what does the ego have to offer you? It's lost its position as this... a spiritual master that's giving you this wise counseling. It's lost that position now. So it's furious. It's angry. It says, what can I do? You know, I don't have any more authority, no more capacity to deceive you. It feels very unstable, like it's run out of tricks. Well, so what? The ego's run out of tricks. It can no longer intimidate or bully us when we see through these things. Of course, it will try. It's got no other tricks up its sleeve. Same old stuff. Choose to embrace the one exception as if that were better. That's the ultimate. Or choose to wait until choosing a new idea, as if you're going to get a better deal that way by waiting. There you go. So we have covered a lot of territory here, essential territory. During these times of crisis, because once again we are heading towards a tsunami of modification in this world, which will deepen, those who pay attention to that, it will deepen forgetfulness of what we really are, which is that which cannot be modified. We're used to it, sort of a base level of modification. In truth, everything is ceaselessly being modified around in existence, everything, but we're used to it. And it's kind of, we call it normal. Everything is normal. But there are times that the ego sets up where there's a very intense, rapid modification that's beyond what we are used to as normal. And that's like leaves a very powerful impression upon us that, wow, modification really is true. You know, everything. Reality must be subject to modification too, because look at the power of modification. It's so powerful and intense. So the ego gives that jolt to us from time to time to keep us in a condition of deep forgetfulness. So what we must do is we must sidestep this tsunami of modification. Tsunami meaning something that is very quick, very intense, very unexpected, very powerful, bringing about massive modifications in a very strong way. It's a good analogy, good symbol to use, effective, because it conveys, we all know, in viewing that Japanese tsunami of the devastating modifications that came about from that. And likewise, the ego is poised to bring about devastating modifications here on this planet. And I pointed out, I've been shown that what's going to happen, and given, you know, a basic timeline, not exact, it's not possible really to pinpoint exactly, it's not necessary, but I was shown that there will be too many crises, financial crises, and after each one of those crises, it will scare us, it will shake us up, and we'll think, oh, the sky is falling, but then things seem to recover, and we say, gee, it's not so bad. And after that, boom, total crash, financial crash, stock market will crash, world financial system will crash, and the machinery of commerce, everything will grind to a halt. It has to do with Spain and Portugal. Those are the keys to it. The two mini crises have already taken place. Took place one in November of last year, where the European Union decided to give massive infusion to all the banks in Europe because the banks were on the verge of going bankrupt. The whole banking system was on the verge of bankruptcy in Europe. And if they hadn't received this massive infusion of printed money, they would have collapsed then. And the second crisis was when the Greeks almost rejected the austerity measures, which would have caused default. And the those who held Greek debt, they almost decided they wouldn't accept the severe losses on the debt that they held, but they finally reached an agreement. So that was the second mini crisis, which almost caused a meltdown in European finances. And so seemingly we've gotten past those two crises, but now the third one is coming up, where Greece, in their political change there, the will of the Greek people is now turning against austerity measures, and they're on the verge of rejecting them, and basically leaving the European Union and defaulting on their debt. And this will, Spain is in a horrible situation, this will cause Spain to melt down as well. And of course Portugal's already melted down. So with Spain melting down, that will bring down it will cause the dominoes to fall. So it's very likely that this is going to take place in 2012. We're seeing the ominous rumblings right now, and people are starting once again to talk about, you know, there is really a collapse coming. Because when people see this coming and realizing that Europe is going to go into this tremendous meltdown of recession, and the value of stocks will tumble, and people will take the profits, desperately try to get whatever profits they can out of their investments, and that will cause a run on the stock market, and cause a collapse of the stock market, which will then, and banks will then cease lending, desperately trying to protect their assets, and then no money will be flowing, and then the oil that drives commerce and distribution, everything, will cause the engine to overheat, lack of any of that money, fluidity of money will cause the engines of commerce to overheat, and the whole thing will seize up, and we'll have, you know, a world crisis. And that's the beginning of the vast modifications that the ego has planned for us. That's like the earthquake, and then all the social modifications we experience from that economic earthquake is like the tsunami hitting the world, causing just everything to change here. Drastic changes. And those who go through that will get this massive dose of modification, thinking that, yeah, you know, the reality must be modifiable. And then they fall prey then to the ego's deceptions of the ego offering this deal, saying, hey, you know what? Yeah, I can, there's a way out of this, which is accepting the belief that one modification is a vastly better deal than many. One belief that truth can be modified in one way is a vastly better deal than many ways. And then the new belief, you know, this belief will reassert itself, maybe on a worldwide basis. We'll have like a universal religion, ego's religion, ego's belief system may become worldwide. Everybody then will feel that they must pressure everybody else into it. As I've said, the ego tries to hide the ineffectiveness of it by claiming that everybody has to buy into it. So there'll be pressure that everybody in the world has to buy into this belief that one exception to truth is salvation. And they'll wrap it up in the robes of sanctity. And everybody has to buy into this. There'll be massive pressure. All of that is coming. All of that is coming, which is why this Christ Clarity Satsang is so important, so vital for those who are fortunate enough to listen to it and pay attention to it, telling you you can sidestep it and showing you how simple it is by exercising your authority, your God-given authority, unmodifiable authority to choose a new idea, and the automatic arising of the effect that cannot be modified, and then the automatic remembrance of what you really are from abiding in that effect. Ramana Maharshi called it abide in the self. Abide in that feeling, abide in that experience. Just experience it. Moment by moment by moment, just experience it. And that will truly remind you of what you are, and you will know you, what you are cannot be modified at all. And you realize that everything, all this modification is simply a fantasy. It's a dream. It's an imagination. It's an imaginary, hypothetical scenario that has zero effect on what you are. What you are is completely untouched by dreams of modification. You will realize that for certain. That's what the touchstones tell us. That's their testimony. And I absolutely believe their testimony. Having glimpsed it, I know what they're saying is true. I know it. And the only difference between me and you and these touchstones is that we are still affected by a little bit of guilt. The ego's tricks and marketing still has a little bit of, casts a little bit of doubt in us. Like, gee, maybe I better wait, because maybe I'm stupid if I don't wait, because it's stupid to accept it now if it's going to be more later, right? And we say, gee, I don't want to be stupid. I don't want to get less than others. The ego claims that somehow if we accept it now, we'll be bypassed by all those who wait and get more later. So we'll end up with crumbs compared to what they end up with. Total lie, okay? A total lie. Devastating lie, isn't it? Because if you buy into that, you then will believe that you don't want crumbs when everybody else is going to have more. You feel you'll be, you know, somehow the lowest person on the totem pole. However great it is, however great the bliss is you'll experience now, that you'll believe that everyone else is going to get much, much, much more, much, much, much better. And you'll be impoverished by comparison. That's dualistic thinking. That is dualistic belief. It's false. What you get now will be exactly the same as what those get who will wait. Exactly the same. Zero difference. And they will get no less by waiting either. You'll all be on exactly the same level, which is truth, which is unmodifiable truth. Be exactly the same level, which means there's no levels at all. You'll simply be abiding in truth with full power, full authority, all access, aspects of spirit. That's guaranteed, unavoidable. So the ego's lie that somehow you're being stupid by not waiting, that's a devastating lie that traps us, scares us. Because nobody is going to make a choice that they feel will impoverish them relative to all other aspects of spirit. Nobody will do that. No way. The ego even claims that those who have chosen it have somehow made a great sacrifice for us, as if they accepted less to show us the way, but we're going to get more. Totally untrue. Those who have chosen overlay are getting exactly the quality that we will get whenever we decide to choose it. Exactly the same quality. Zero difference. And they know that. They know that. There's no sacrifice. They're not making a sacrifice for us. They're not getting less. They're getting the same. And the one that goes very last, they'll get the same too. They won't get less for being, you know, foolish for so long. No, not at all. So it's an equal playing field. Playing field of truth is totally equal for all. Always will be. So we could go on and on and on. Bringing to light, shedding light on the ego's tricks that bind us. We've talked about three of them here. Well, actually, two, really, but the second one had sort of a further development in that somehow waiting, we're going to get a better deal. And the flip side of that is somehow choosing now, we're going to get less than others. Two sides of one coin. One appeals to the ego's trying to be magnanimous to us and like giving us a tip, hot stock tip, like, hey, if you just wait to enter the market, you're going to get a much better deal. And the other then appeals to our fear of scarcity and lack and saying, if we choose now, we'll get less, much, much less, and others will have much, much more, which implies that they'll somehow have vast, control over us. because we know in this world, those who seem to have, you know, much, much more than others are able to control others, sort of enslave them. So we fear that, thinking a reality that others will have more than us and they'll be able to enslave us. Total lie. Okay. Vicious lie, isn't it? Because the fact is that everyone will have equal quality. Reality, truth, is not modifiable. It's always a fact, always will be a fact. And that's the quality of reality that all experience, all aspects of spirit experience that. 100% is 100%. There's no difference. There's no such thing as 110%. No such thing as 90%. It's 100%. It's total. No exception. No exception. No exception. This bears repeating. Frees you from the ego's deception. No exception, frees from deception. And that's what's emphasized here. No exception, frees from deception. That's what's emphasized. That's what needs to be emphasized. That gives you the leverage that is needed. Gives us the leverage. That's what leverage is all about. Realizing there is no exception to truth. There is no modification of truth. Truth is 100% true. That's what gives us the leverage we need. And I'm sure you can feel that. You can see it. When you see it, you feel it. You say, wow. Wow, that's great. Great news. The gospel means great news. Teaching the gospel, bringing the gospel, just simply means bringing the good news. Bringing the good news that there's no exception to truth. And in hearing this and being reminded of it, we then get the leverage we need to dispel the ego's tricks and stand up to the ego and say, aha, I see through your tricks. It's just delay. All it is delay. Self-deception that we are employing so that we can continue our delusion that we can be prime creator. Continue with our pride thinking, hey, we have a way to be prime creator. The ego is just using these tactics to delay. To delay the inevitable that we will choose. The idea of not trying to be prime creator and therefore experience the overlay and therefore be given perfect remembrance of what we are. And then we will then be able to function the way we were created to function flawlessly and choose other ideas and experience them. We'll even go beyond perfect remembrance to direct functionality. Direct experiencing, spontaneous direct experiencing. We'll even, at some point, we'll even go to that, but not yet. First comes the perfect remembrance, which is what we're focused on. All satsangs must be focused on this. Satsang, again, is listening to clarification concerning truth, which is ultimately the responsibility and the necessity for everyone. It's a necessity. It's not something that's enforced. It's a necessity. Nobody can avoid it. It's not up to us to set the options. It's not up to us to determine what is necessary. Reality determines what is necessary. And any attempt to forget what reality is automatically has a necessity to relinquish that attempt. No two ways about it. No two ways about it. Duality is deception. We've seen through the ego's deception here in this hour plus. And I have to say that I've been able to provide another, share another satsang, which is, it was just as good as the previous one. Slightly different, but just as good. That was a challenge. It's not easy to lose a great effort and then to bounce back from it. But sometimes it's necessary. You know, the ego will trick us and trick us and trick us, and we realize we've been tricked our entire lives and many lives, and we have to bounce back from that and just say, you know, at some point we have to see through the trickeration. We have to see that the ego is really giving us nothing, offering us nothing, and also offering us terrible advice, ridiculous advice that we're supposed to wait. We'll get more if we wait, or if we don't wait, we'll get less. totally wrong and false advice, and offering us that, saying that one exception to truth is salvation, that it's somehow different than other, many exceptions to truth. It's actually offering us nothing at all. It's offering us 100% rejection of truth, is what it's offering us. No difference. So it's no deal. It's offering us no deal. And then crying crocodile tears when we reject it, as if we've somehow insulted the ego. Ah, the ego is so easily insultable. So easy. Very emotional. The ego is so easy, so sensitive. Sensitivo, you know. Oh, how dare we turn our backs on this magnanimous deal that it's offering us. Oh, that's so awful. We're so terrible. We should feel so guilty for that, you know. This guilt trip the ego puts on us, we're supposed to feel so guilty for not fully embracing what the ego has to offer us. You know, when we experience the ineffectiveness of the ego's offer of embracing one exception to truth and trying to sanctify that, now the ego will say, hey, we're not embracing it enough. We need to embrace it fully. Somehow we're holding back. There's something within us that's holding us back. We just need to get rid of that. Now, the problem is that how can we embrace nothing fully? Because we are spirit. We can't embrace rejection of spirit fully. It's impossible. We can only dream about it. But that's not a complete full rejection. Not an actual forgetting. It's a state of forgetfulness. But it's a fluctuating, fragile, temporary state. It'll always be that way. And the ego tells us, hey, you know, all we have to do is fully embrace its deal, its one exception. And that will magically then completely fulfill us. And we won't feel like we're missing anything. And we'll become total. That's a complete lie. That's like saying if we totally believe that one exception to truth is possible, that one exception will then be true. Magical thinking, right? Magical thinking. Ludicrous thinking. Ludicrous logic. Believing that somehow belief exercise perfectly trumps truth. Where did this authority in belief come from? That it's somehow there's some power that trumps truth. It comes from our fantasy, from our desire, from our imaginings, from our desire to be prime creator. As if we just believe that we're prime creator perfectly, believe it perfectly, somehow we will be prime creator. Which means we have invented some power and authority that God did not create. God did not create belief. Belief is an invention of spirit. It's an imagination. It's an invented false authority. There is no authority in reality. God didn't give some authority for something to modify God or to change God or to enable spirit to be prime creator and displace God. We simply believe we have the authority, and we believe if we believe it perfectly, it will be so. That's called magical thinking. That's another way the ego entraps us, makes us feel inadequate. Like, gee, if we're failing to do something which is doable, but the fact is that what we're attempting is impossible, so we're not failing. Failure only has meaning if what we're attempting is possible. If it's impossible, then the whole notion of failure is zero. There's no meaning to it whatsoever. Failure implies that we can possibly succeed, right? And that we're failing. Failure means we're not able to do what can be done. And that if we just try harder, that we can get rid of this failure, sense of failure. The ego tells us we can get rid of this feeling of failure. No, the way we get rid of it is to reject it in the first place, that there is no failure. We don't accept failure is true and then get rid of it. We say that the attempt to accomplish impossible was impossible from the very beginning. Never was possible. So there's zero failure. So there's zero guilt. No sense of failure at all in us. The overlay is there for us perfectly. It doesn't say, gee, you know, you've been failing. No, the overlay knows that you've never failed at all. Because the impossible, one cannot fail at that. One can only realize that it's impossible. We've simply been delaying. That's all. Delaying isn't failure. It's folly, yes, but not failure. All we've been engaged in is folly. Whimsical action and choice. Whimsical folly. That's all. No failure. No guilt. Guilt, how can we have guilt? We have not modified truth in the slightest bit. And should we feel guilty for failing to accomplish the impossible? No. We should recognize it's folly. And folly is treatable. Because by choosing a new idea, goodbye folly, no more folly. By experiencing the overlay, we remember perfectly what we are. Goodbye forgetfulness. Case closed. Just like that. That simple. Case closed. All right. Very great. That's it.